Hello everyone and welcome back to a brand new video where today we return once again with, of course, more Knowing Wheel. It's the run-up to Christmas, of course. Apparently there's been a football tournament going on and I seem to have been joined. I think he's flown in from Qatar. It is, I forgot his name, Fabio Capello has joined me. I ruined my own roast of Jamie.
We literally scripted that joke a minute ago.
We did.
You've already butchered it.
I have butchered the joke, sadly, yes. But how are we doing, mate?
I'm good. I'm pleased that Lionel Messi is the GOAT. And yeah, excited to talk about some F1 in the depths of winter, but here we are.
Exactly. And I tell you what, because of course the World Cup being on as well, no one seems to have been talking about Formula 1 recently. There are a few news stories to go over as we head into, I think this is episode 91 or 92 of the Knowing Wheel podcast. We are getting very, very close to our centenary episode. We've got a lot planned for that. So definitely, if you're not already, please make sure you give us a follow on Spotify and like the video here on YouTube. But yeah, of course, we've got a few bits of news to go through. You know, the last couple of weeks, we've been trying to sort of slowly build up news to get into one episode. And then we've sort of got a fun little Christmas-themed thing, but World Cup-themed thing as well on the channel today. So Jamie, start us off. What on earth has been going on with F1 Team Principles?
Yeah, happily they all they waited until the time between us recording last week's podcast and the podcast releasing have a massive shake-up of Team Principles in 2023. So kind of the worst kept secret of all, which kind of kickstarted it, was Mattia Binotto, my Italian comrade, getting binned by Ferrari. And they weirdly picked out Fred Vasseur as their first choice, or as their only likely first choice, because apparently there was rumours that they spoke to Christian Horner and Toto Wolff, but I don't think that was ever a thing.
They would have.
Yeah, they would have spoken to them, but then immediately been hit with a no.
Exactly.
So that kind of kickstarted it. He's obviously quite underperformed at Ferrari, especially this year. The previous few, obviously the disaster of 2020 wasn't really his fault, and then after that it's been fairly steady progress, but then this year there were so many things wrong with that team. And it's actually their first outside appointment at team principal since Ross Brawn, which I find quite interesting.
Yeah.
Because all the other times they've been promoted from within. So it might be a good thing for Ferrari that they've gone for Fred Vasseur. Alfa Romeo / Sauber were kind of okay to let him go. Obviously, it's the biggest story in motorsport. You can't really complain about his desire to leave when there's a much bigger job on offer. And also with Sauber getting taken over by Audi for 2026, they were looking to change for that anyway, so it wasn't the worst thing that it happened a bit earlier.
I was just gonna say, let's be fair, you don't give Ferrari who they want, they'll just turn around and go, well, have fun trying to wheel your cars around next year.
Yeah, true. Have a Cosworth engine, how about that? It is a slightly weird appointment because he hasn't really got an amazing track record, Fred Vasseur. Like, he's been solid at Alpha/ Sauber since the time he was there, but if I remember rightly, he was at Renault for a short period of time since when they returned in 2016, and didn't do all that. Again, he was solid, but nothing that screams promote me to a big team.
But has anyone done anything at Renault? Can you do anything at Renault?
True. He was better than Cyril, but then that wasn't very hard.
No.
Hopefully it's good. I do like Fred Vasseur. I hope that the toxicity of Ferrari doesn't screw him over completely. But yeah.
No. And I think, you know, it was a very interesting stat that you just gave out there, that it's the first outside of Ferrari signing since Ross Brawn. It really does feel like maybe now, because when was Ross Brawn picked up by Ferrari? 1997, wasn't it?
Must have been 7, yeah.
I think it was 97. It really does feel like now we're starting potentially to see the second sort of Schumacher era of Ferrari, if you will. You know, they've got this driver, obviously not quite the same storyline as Schumacher, but they've got a very, very talented driver in Charles Leclerc, although he has obviously been Ferrari backed since he was about 6. They're picking up external team managers. They've had recent years where they've had a car that could have fought for the championship and they've just missed out. Could we see the 2026 regulations be Ferrari domination?
That's a long way away.
It's a long way away.
Charlotte will still be around by then if he has a choice.
But I think that's why they picked up Fred.
Yeah, because I do think it's very much to appease Leclerc.
Him and Fred even, I think, are a very, very close-knit couple of guys. And it is starting to feel as well, I'm going to actually reference football here, Jamie, so please correct me if I'm wrong. But it is starting to feel like Charles has kind of got a Kylian Mbappe reign over Ferrari, yeah, like he has with PSG. It feels like there's a lot of control there that people don't realise yet.
Yeah, yeah. And it's probably good for Leclerc. He'll definitely be the teacher's pet, as it were. He'll be number one driver for no doubt now, if he wasn't already. But yeah, that kind of obviously set the dominoes into effect with the rest of the team principals on the grid, which all happened really quickly and kind of unexpectedly as well. But Audi / Sauber were also obviously looking for a new team principal. And I think they probably did the best business out of anyone, if I say so.
I would agree with that.
Andreas Seidel from McLaren, who's done a very, very solid job since being appointed team principal there. They've poached him, and he was under contract, so they must have agreed a fee and everything. But yeah, he's off to Audi for 2023 and beyond, which I think is very good all round for Andreas and for Alfa Romeo.
Yeah, it's an interesting one, isn't it? Andreas Seidel to Alfa Romeo, of course. He's effectively now going to be my boss come the new year. But it does... I mean, again, I think a lot of people have kind of thought it seems like a bit of a backward step for him. He's been Audi through and through throughout most of his life, or under the Audi umbrella, sorry, of course, with Porsche at Le Mans. It's not really that surprising that he's gone there. And I mean, he'd already come out to Zak Brown earlier on this year saying that even at the end of 2025... he wouldn't be re-signing with McLaren. So, I mean, don't get me wrong, Andreas Seidel, I think, is in Formula 1 quite underappreciated still, because he has done absolute just the business around the rest of motorsport. You know, he's highly respected within Formula 1 itself, but I think a lot of the fans don't give him the credit he deserves. He's a very, very intelligent man, and he knows how to run any sort of motorsport team. And with Audi coming in, of course, they're going to be slowly picking up that stake in Alfa Romeo, although technically it's not till 2026. There's going to be, it feels more and more like there's going to be big Audi influence and big Audi money coming into that team before then.
And they could easily be a team on an upward trajectory by then. Like, if they can build on this sixth place constructors, if they're finishing like fifth or fourth at the point of Audi taking over, suddenly that's a massive force in F1 that could be battling for championships.
Well, you just think, don't you? You know, we're kind of always played up in the perfect world, don't we? But we've got Ferrari, Red Bull, Mercedes battling at the front. You get some Audi backing him. You've got, hopefully, them there as well. You get McLaren back as well. Could we end up in a bit of a golden era in Formula 1, where we've got sort of four or five teams that have got the potential to be right there?
Yeah, I don't see why not. And obviously Aston Martin is still around with a lot of money. They're not really doing very much with it, but...
not yet.
You never know.
But that's going to be... I don't know what it is about the Aston Martin sort of... but the vibe still feels to me like it's going to be more MasterCard Lola than big team that sort of moves to the front. I don't know why, but I just feel like Lawrence Stroll still has too much influence
on that team. Well,
they're already going
to have one hand tied behind their back anyway with their second driver every year.
Exactly.
So,
doesn't help.
Yeah. But yeah, moving back to the team principals, obviously... McLaren were then in need of a new team principal, and they've actually promoted from within, which I think makes a lot of sense for the position they're in, and they've gone for a very similar named Andreas Stella to Andreas Seidel.
Didn't have to change many of the letters on his door.
Exactly. same initial, so no new jumpers, or I don't think they wear jumpers at McLaren, but they're polo shirts. I think it makes good sense. Obviously he's been around the block for years, Andreas Stella. Race engineer, sorry, to Schumacher, Raikkonen, Alonso at Ferrari. He's done it all, really. So, apart from being a team principal, so it does make sense. I think it's a natural step, and he's been working his influence more and more in that McLaren team. So, he was kind of the next in line, it felt, and it makes sense that they've kept the ship steady by just promoting from within.
And it didn't really feel like there was going to be anyone else available that could have been an upgrade, did it, either? Mm. It feels like Alfa Romeo were kind of the one that's taken a big leap forward. Again, I would quite like to go back to Ferrari quickly, if I'm honest. In that, obviously, we mentioned Ross Brawn. But I think it's something ridiculous. Like, since Toto Wolff came into Mercedes and obviously Christian Horner at Red Bull, Ferrari have had 5 team principals.
Oh, yeah.
In that time. Do we believe Fred Vasseur is going to stop the merry-go-round of in and out of team principals?
To be honest, probably not. That there's something deeply wrong with that team right now. So if he can address that,
well, it's
then
Ferrari,
I don't see why
not. There's always been something deeply wrong.
Yeah.
I don't know. Like I said a minute, I really do wonder whether this is sort of Ferrari now going. The only way we can win is if we basically do what we did with Schumi back in the late 90s into the 2000s. I think it's going to take a couple of years of setting up, but I do wonder whether we'll look back in 10 years on episode 2604 and we go, Fred Vasseur, he was quite a jokester, but he came into Ferrari and he turned him around.
Potentially. You never know. You never know. I would be surprised, but you heard it here first from Matt212.
You know what? I'm going to back it. I'm going to stick with that. And then in 6 months when he's been dropped after Ferrari don't win a single race, you all can laugh at me. And I guess the last one that we really need to discuss that still hasn't actually been finalised, has it, Jamie? Or haven't had any sort of follow-up from it, is Jos Capito and FX de Maison both leaving Williams seemingly out of nowhere.
Yeah, and there's no real, I get to take it back to football analogy. When teams change manager, you can kind of tell if a team is good by the fact if they have a second manager lined up to replace them.
Yeah.
Because they kind of got, they've got their ducks in a row. They know what they're doing. Like, they've got someone to replace the outgoing manager. Williams haven't really done that. And they've just got rid of their two, key men. And not done anything to replace them. It seems a bit odd. I hear rumblings that Doriton, obviously their investment company, so if there is profit, they wouldn't mind selling Williams right now, which would be a shame, I think. But if they sell them to the right people, it would be good.
But who do they sell them to?
Yeah, that's the thing. Andretti came back.
Well, this was going to be another thing we were going to discuss in a minute, isn't it? Of course, Andretti now have got a big investment firm willing to back them into Formula One.
Yeah.
It really does. It just doesn't bode well for Williams, does it? Like, let's be fair. Apart from me, when we did the Williams livery reveal last year, no one was really expecting them to do particularly well in 2022. I didn't have them fifth. I might have said in the heat of the moment they might come sixth. And then I even predicted him still 8th by the end of the year. But Williams, they were still comfortably the back marker team. So it kind of feels like, because Jos Capito hasn't gone somewhere else, again, a lot of us thought he was going to go to Alfa Romeo when obviously Fred Vasseur left.
And everything
else. Of course,
else
because he was part of the VW group, everything like that. Mm-hmm. He hasn't. What has he seen in that team that's made him want to just get out of there as quickly as possible?
Yeah, that's kind of why I think where I think the rumours of them wanting to sell has come from, because obviously if you change management, you're going to be under scrutiny anyway. He probably doesn't want that, and especially if he wasn't getting what he wanted in terms of backing from the owners, then you might as well just get out with a bit of credibility, because he has done a good job at Williams, I think.
Yeah,
obviously got their first podium in however long, in 2021?
4 years.
And only 4 years, wow. Williams really did used to be all right.
it does. I'm going to ask you this question then, Jamie. Does it feel like when the Williams documentary comes out in 5 years from now that this was the last little peak before the final nail in the coffin? Bless her. Claire always seemed like a lovely person, but she was not cut out to be an F1 team principal.
No.
Does it feel like we kind of had this rebirth with Jos Capito coming in, and then
George Russell.
A 10-minute bit at the end of the movie, but then it goes and it still didn't work and they went bankrupt and that was it and the Williams story was over?
I really, really hope not. But
So do I.
Yeah. If Williams are in F1 by 2030, I'd be surprised. There's one to come back to as well. Oh, when we're saying
it's Fred horrible,
Vasseur,
isn't it?
Yeah. Fred Vasseur, 10-time world champion driver and constructor, and Williams are gone. There's your 2030 calls.
Okay, we're gonna have to write those down somewhere. It's so difficult, isn't it? Because again, I think we both love Williams, but you're just not convinced at the moment, are we still?
Yeah, it's like, where's the future? Where's the plan?
Yeah, exactly.
Doesn't really seem to be one.
Like, again, I think the only sort of likely thing to save them is, you know, maybe, you know, I know we've mentioned it before, of course, with, you know, Honda potentially looking to come back in, whether Honda buy them out rather than AlphaTauri, if Red Bull still want those two teams. But it just feels like they need big investment from somewhere. And
from a manufacturer, I think.
We'd kind of hoped it was Porsche, but it's not really going to happen, is it?
No, no. Which is a shame. But yeah, they're looking for a team principal. If they want to hire us, then I'm willing.
Yeah, we'll do it. We'll quite happy to do it. I reckon we'd
got
be great
of hours
team principals.
Actually, I don't have any hours in F1 Manager, but plenty in Football Manager.
I've got a ridiculous amount in F1 Manager because apparently I only found out recently my game never closes correctly.
Oh,
so
great.
I think I've got something ridiculous like 800 hours on F1 Manager because I do like 168 hours a week.
Great. There you go. Sign us up.
Get us in. Get us in, Williams. We'll turn it around. We'll turn it around. Shall we get then, Jamie, into the other big thing that we wanted to do on today's show?
Yes. Inspired by a certain YouTube channel that is apparently doing some vote thing at the minute.
There is. There is. I'm going to have to get up those votes as well, actually, quickly, before I forget. We'll do that as well. Let me just move that out of the way of the bracket. So, of course, as many of you will already be aware, I've been running over on the community tab on our YouTube channel. If you're on Spotify and you don't watch the YouTube videos, we've been running a bit of a poll recently. I actually used Jamie to help me pick out here. So we picked 64.
He uses me all the time.
That seems like a really cry for help, Jamie, I'll be honest, but okay.
Hidden messages throughout the podcast.
Oh, here we go, yes. I'll tell him off after the show. So, we picked out 64 Formula One drivers, the 34 F1 champions, and 30 other F1 drivers. And we decided to run a poll over on the channel to try and find the GOAT of Formula One. Now, some of them have come out with some interesting results. We won't get too much into it today, but there have been a couple of votes that I feel have left something to be desired. We've done things slightly differently, you know, to try and keep the length of the show down. We've just picked out 32 F1 drivers. They are 32 Formula One world champions, and I let Jamie pick the two that were being dropped. So, Jamie, could you just tell me quickly who got scrapped?
I mean, it was a tough decision. It wasn't really. I dropped Keke Rosberg because he wasn't going to win until Pirelli lost his legs. And then
that's one way of putting it.
I also dropped Jacques Villeneuve because Schumacher's the GOAT and Villeneuve turned in.
Jacques Villeneuve was on the inside.
Yeah, true. But no, Villeneuve's gone. Rookie merchant, rubbish. Out in 3 years.
I do still argue that Williams was one of the most unbelievably cars of good all time that people don't realise. 1996, yeah. That's generally one of my theories when we get into spooky Formula One stories in the future, that I believe 1996 and 1997 Williams were absolutely like sickeningly OP, but they just had two pretty mediocre drivers in them.
Yeah.
And Schumacher
so
was just
those
better.
Two, we've been Keke and we've been Jacques Villeneuve.
Yeah, so the father of another world champion and the son of a driver that should have been world champion.
Yeah.
So,
I mean, that leads us to 32.
I've also let you deal with the seeding today. Now, I do read the comments on the community tab. For some reason, people over there seem to believe I rigged the polls. I don't get why you'd think I'd do that. Like, I don't gain anything from doing that. It's kind of just meant to be a bit of fun because there was no Formula One on. Okay.
Yeah.
But I've let Jamie do the polls today, so if you want to hurl abuse, hurl it in his direction.
Do it.
You can see his ad on Twitter here, so I'm ready. So yeah, hurl your abuse at Jamie on Twitter if that's your jam. But you've sorted out the groups today.
Yes, I have. And I think we'll rattle through the first round fairly quickly. So
probably.
What, the round of 32?
The round of 32. Bracket. The first
and
bracket.
It's quite a heavy hitter, number one. Two
well,
former
it is
teammates
the
to each
Mercedes
other.
Mercedes 2010 to 2012 lineup. And of course, the man that actually beat two seven time world champions in Equal Machinery.
In Equal Machinery.
But we are talking about. Are we talking overall career, Jamie? Are we talking best season?
No,
are we
overall
talking
career.
Entire career? Okay, fair
this
enough.
Is to find the GOAT, since
this
one GOAT has been found
GOAT.
This weekend in Lionel Messi.
Exactly. Exactly.
So, yeah. And we're going to disagree, but there we go. We know it's going to happen already.
I don't think we're going to disagree on that many, though.
Until the final. There's no way I'm backing down on who I
think. Yeah, there's going to be a lot of debate up towards that point, but I feel like we're going to agree on a lot of them early on.
Yeah.
So, I mean,
yeah.
Schumacher, Rosberg. I mean, this round of 32 we can rattle through pretty quickly, isn't it?
Yeah.
Schumacher's taking that.
Yes.
And this website that you've picked is really slow.
1-0.
Schumacher wins 1-0. What?
Oh, this is a lot of...
Eh?
There we go.
How do I... No, it's not worked. This website is so... I let Jamie try and pick this.
Yeah.
Verify the winner, Michael Schumacher. There we go. Thank you very much.
All right, nice.
Alonso versus Verstappen.
This is actually quite hard.
So, this was also a point I wanted to raise quickly before we get into any... I was actually going to raise it, you know, just in a fun point somewhere during the winter break, but I feel like now is a good enough time to mention it. Imagine, Jamie, for just 1 second, that Perez got scrapped by Red Bull. Close your eyes, Jamie. I want you to close your eyes. Picture this. So, Red Bull decide, in the process, they're going to pick up Felipe Drugovich.
Right.
And he beats Max Verstappen next year.
That's an impossibility.
That's what Hamilton did in 2007.
Is it?
It's mad to think about, isn't it? Like, when you try and sort of put it together.
But would Red Bull start favouring Felipe Drugovich because they've been backing him from youth? I don't think they would.
McLaren didn't back Lewis.
They did.
Mercedes backed Lewis. Mercedes were the ones paying Lewis, not McLaren.
As it's a very close call, but I think just because of the potential, I do think Verstappen ahead of Alonso.
Verstappen will win. Oh, sorry, we're going back to that now, are we? You've completely.
Oh yeah, I was just. Yeah, I went ahead of your point. Yeah.
So. Oh yeah, like Alonso. Don't get me wrong; he's been fantastic.
He's unfortunate
pretty much his
entire to be matched against Verstappen in round one.
Unfortunate to go up against Verstappen in round one, but Verstappen will win more Formula One world championships. He's not going to be done at two, is he?
No, whether
he'll end up with sort of three or four, and we'll go, he could have had more had this or that happened, or he got four a bit like Seb, tried to go somewhere else and it didn't work. I don't think he's going to end up like Seb, but you never know. But Verstappen is... But Alonso has proven he can deliver it for 20 years, pretty much. Is it fair
to
discount
him? Tarso Marquez.
He did lose to Hamilton as well.
Marquez clear. I think Verstappen still. I think Alonso is a very, very fast driver, obviously. He's relentless, but he does screw himself by making everything around him toxic.
Verstappen's getting more and more like that, though. He came up with a comment just a couple of days ago, didn't he? Talking about how number two drivers have got to get out of fairy tale land. And I mean, if that isn't a shot of Checo, I don't know what is.
Yeah.
It wouldn't surprise me if we look back in 10 years and go, how on earth did Verstappen just end up doing an Alonso?
Potentially. I think he's got... I don't want to say that. He's got a higher ceiling, Verstappen has, than Alonso.
Getting controversial. Jamie, just say that again for me.
The Spanish are going to come for me.
Say that for me for the clip.
Verstappen does have a higher ceiling than Alonso.
You've heard it here.
Obviously, right now he does, because he's not 41.
No. I've already cut the clip at that
He's
point,
clipped
Jamie.
It already. Great.
I've clipped it. It's
Put
done.
Verstappen
it's over.
Through. Move on.
We're putting Verstappen through. Okay.
Yeah. Oh, the hate. I can feel it already.
There we go. So Verstappen versus Schumacher next round. That's going to be fun. So, I feel like we probably ought to talk, actually, a little bit more about the drivers, especially some of the older ones. So, Niki Lauda, 3-time Formula One world champion. The greatest comeback, I'd argue, in any sport ever.
Anything
Is that a fair
ever.
Assumption? Pretty much in anything ever,
Other
yeah.
Other than Jesus.
I'm being quiet for a second. I don't
we'll
know how to go
that.
On from here. Okay, you're right. And Mario Andretti, of course, American Formula One world champion. It was actually in the same era as Niki Lauda, wasn't it? Mario Andretti won his Formula One World Champion. No, it was the 70s.
70s, close
Andretti. Of course, pretty much, I think it's often forgotten in Formula One circles, Mario Andretti was ridiculous in everything that he drove, whether it was Formula One, in America, things like that. But Lauda is going to have to pick this one, isn't he? Yeah, don't get definitely. Me. I feel like Andretti has slept on a lot, but Niki Lauda is just different
Lauda's
gravy.
On the fringe of the top five, potentially in the top five of all time, I think.
He's certainly within my top 10 of all time, is Niki Lauda.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
So Lauda is going to make
we'll
it
send
through.
Him through.
We'll send him through.
Deserves the 76 one as well.
He did. He should have won 70. That's what I was going to talk about with James Hunt. Bless him.
Speaking of,
Rush sells this story really well, but James Hunt wasn't actually particularly brilliant. Like, don't get me wrong, good Formula One driver, but not great.
No.
I feel like I'm going to get some hate for that, but he was nowhere near Niki Lauda's level.
He did well to get his championship, but ultimately, I mean,
Rush
they say it at the end of Rush, don't they?
Yeah.
They do say it at the end of Rush, where like, Hunt was not destined for greater things. I think Lauda definitely was, which we saw with the amount of championships they both won.
Exactly. Nelson
and
Piquet,
the other driver he's against, Nelson Piquet, the man who shall not be named, is unfortunately going to have to go through, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Three-time champ. Slept on, because he raced in an era with a lot of unbelievably good drivers and still
and
won three championships.
This is the thing, isn't it? Like, when you remember, he was going up against Prost, Senna, Mansell, and a few other very, very notable names. Mm. To walk away with three world championships in that era, when F1 was probably... you know, you had a lot of incredible
It was more
talents
open
right
than it is
front.
Now.
Yeah, 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 exactly. Exactly. But Nelson Piquet is going to go through in that group. He still doesn't change the fact, though, that he's a horrible human being. We got the four-time champion.
This one should be fairly
Alan
straightforward.
Prost going up against Damon Hill. We've already spoken about Damon Hill so far, of course. Absolutely gifted a Formula One World Championship in what was probably the weirdest Formula One career we've ever seen.
Made his debut at 30, which is bizarre.
Made his debut at 30. Could have been a two-time Formula One World Champion, which is scary to think about, isn't it?
Mm. Did turn in on Schumacher, though.
He didn't turn in on Schumacher.
No, he
Schumacher
didn't. He just sent it, didn't he, into no braking zone.
It's weird, isn't it? We've mentioned this before, but 1994 looks way less obvious than 1997.
Yeah, definitely. And I think they released... they released some footage from Damon Hill's onboard that I hadn't seen before.
Yeah,
in the last
few years.
And
it does look,
it looks like he just sends it for no real reason when
I think,
Schumacher
to be honest,
quite clearly has damage.
Yeah.
Yeah. But Alain Prost is going to go through this. We'll chat about
Oh, absolutely.
Later, sure.
Alain Prost, again, incredibly slept on, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Four world championship. Again, like we said, you know, he was going up
against
Piquet.
Against Senna.
He was going up against Senna as well. Like, he was right up there. And I mean, again, the same thing goes for this next group, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Jim Clark. He's
unbelievable.
Up there, isn't he?
He's right up
there. Within the proper GOAT circle. Isn't he?
He could do things in an F1 car that no one else could do at the time.
Well, not only in a Formula One car. He basically won in everything he competed in, didn't he?
Yeah.
He could win in a washing machine. Jim Clark was that good. The only Formula One driver as well to score maximum available points in a Formula One season. And he did it twice.
That is ridiculous. Yeah.
there were drop rounds back in the day, but still, Jimmy Clark. I mean, Phil Hill, very, very good driver as well. I feel like he's kind of slept upon again. First ever American Formula One World Champion. But Phil Hill was incredibly good as well. But he's gone up against Jim Clark, and I'm sorry. Clark's winning that.
Clark is going to win that. Yeah.
I love the fact as well, if you haven't already guessed, Jamie has signed us up to some random esports league website to do this poll on.
It's like a CSGO tournament site or something like that. I don't even know what it is, to be honest.
You've done well, Jamie. You've done well.
They've got your email now, so enjoy.
They have. I'm going to get spammed with host your next
this
E-League
one
tournament.
Is a bit closer than I think people will give it credit for.
Oh, you're actually going to do this. Yeah, I'm already seeing the comments. Now, Jamie, just
no,
for
I,
a bit of context.
No, I think
just
I'll have
context,
to appease the comments.
We are saying, just briefly, four times more people have voted Sebastian Vettel than Alain Prost in my other competition. Okay. 20,000 people have voted for Sebastian Vettel. About 4,000 have voted for Alain Prost.
In a head-to-head.
In a head-to-head.
Well, it's not mad, actually. Vettel did win four, but...
So did Alain Prost.
Yeah, so did Alain Prost. Vettel against Mansell is actually a really tough one, because Mansell absolutely deserved more than one championship.
Should have definitely... Well, could have won two. Should have won two. Could have won three.
Should have won two. Yeah, exactly. And to go like in an era which was really hard to win. Obviously, his one championship was in one of the most dominant cars of all time.
But he absolutely wiped the floor with his teammate.
Yeah, he did. I think Vettel has to go through.
Oh, yeah.
But
I mean,
Mansell,
you love the mustache.
He's very unlucky.
Yeah, exactly. He's been the unfortunate driver to get put up against Sebastian Vettel in the first round. Right, okay. Graham Hill, John Surtees, two early days legends.
Mm-hmm.
Graham Hill, of course, renowned, I think, for two reasons. Mr. Monaco, five-time winner of the Monaco Grand Prix. And, of course, the only ever driver to win the Triple Crown. He actually, Jamie, as a quick fun fact, went up against Fernando Alonso in my driver polls a couple of weeks ago. Now, remember, Fernando Alonso took 2 years out of Formula One to try and do what Graham Hill did. And that didn't stop, if I quickly find the vote again for you. Here we go. 19,000 votes. Fernando Alonso, 80%. Graham Hill, 18.
That is outrageous.
Fernando couldn't do what Graham Hill did, and five times more people still believed he was better.
I think Graham Hill is somewhere in the top 10 for me.
He's top 10 of all time, absolutely.
I think John Surtees, very unlucky. Only man to win on two wheels and four wheels.
Yep. Slept upon as well. And he won with Ferrari, which instantly gives you more credit.
It's very difficult, as we've seen.
He's the only ever British driver to win the world title with Ferrari, isn't he? If
probably.
I'm not mistaken.
Yeah,
I
would
guess
he
is. Any other Brit has won with him.
Not many have driven for them. Mansell, I can think of, but...
It's also very true.
Yeah. But I think Graham Hill has to go through here, unfortunately, for Mr. Surtees.
Fair enough.
Yeah, Graham Hill, what, two championships early on? And
two world championships, five Monaco Grand Prix, a Le Mans 24, and an Indy 500.
Yeah.
That is just mythical.
In the 1960s with
in
zero
the 60s.
Safety.
Exactly. Next up, then, we've got Hamilton versus Jenson Button. Seven world championships going up against one. However,
if you look at their points tally over three
seasons. Over the three seasons together. JB, I think Jenson beat him 1 year, didn't he? But it was just by quite a lot that meant
Hamilton
that he outscored him
off.
Over the three. Hamilton 2011 is like the forgotten year, isn't it?
It's
that
not forgotten by me because it was very funny.
No, exactly. He just basically spent the year, him and Felipe Massa, just decided to drag out 2008 again for whatever reason.
Yeah.
It was
unfortunately,
great.
We speak about it quite a lot. I think we certainly do it off camera, but Button is kind of that tier below the world champions.
Bless him. We love him. Like,
yeah.
Great. If this was talking about best humans, Button would be right up there, wouldn't he?
Yeah.
Because he was an absolute baller during his
and
time.
And his quality. But in terms of, like, we kind of say, you know, you've got your Schumachers, Hamiltons, Senna, Prost, all that. They're kind of like the greatest. And then you've got the good. And the good are the likes of, like, Kimi Raikkonen to say, like, that's going to get hate.
Oh.
Jenson Button, people
Jamie.
Like that who are slightly below.
Jenson's sort of more in your Nico Rosbergs, isn't it? You get that 1 year where everything goes perfectly. You take a world championship
and you
just run to the bank with it.
Yeah, but Hamilton has to go through here.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Hamilton into the round of 16. But who will he be going up against? It's the battle of the two times, isn't it? Or was Frina? No, Frina
was
just
one.
A single world champion,
first,
wasn't he?
Yeah.
He was the first ever Formula One world champion, going up against the one driver that Michael Schumacher, said he always feared.
Yeah.
Mika Häkkinen.
Yeah, I do think Häkkinen probably has to go through, simply because Frina has one less championship, and despite it being the first one, the Ferrari was ridiculous.
Ferrari just had a lot more money than anyone else that bothered showing up.
They knew what they were doing, more than anyone else.
Well, let's not go that far. Well, Ferrari have never quite known what they're doing.
They probably knew better in 1950 than they do now, actually.
It wouldn't surprise me if their wind tunnel hasn't changed.
Yeah. But yeah, I think Hakkinen has to go through here.
That being said, though, with Mika Hakkinen, absolute legend of the sport, did almost throw away a world championship to Eddie Irvine, though.
He did. And Heinz-Harald Frentzen, even more worryingly.
Yeah.
In a
he
Jordan.
Did bottle two race... Like, don't get me wrong, I think it's often forgotten as well just how difficult those late 90s cars were to drive. Yeah. Whose idea was it to give them V10s, groove tyres, and no traction control?
Yeah, yeah.
That was kind of mental, but Hakkinen did almost throw that one away.
To win... Like, he was winning two races in 1997 and crashed out of both of them on his own accord, which... Not the best move, but he still got the championship, to be fair. And yeah, went toe-to-toe against Schumacher.
But also, on the contrary...
Sorry, 99, not 97.
Yeah, yeah. On the contrary, though, did also out-qualify Ayrton Senna in their first race together.
Yeah, exactly.
It's just weird, isn't it, the way like Formula One works? And I think this is kind of why we wanted to go through all these nuances today, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Formula One's a bizarre sport. It really is.
It really is.
But Hakkinen will make it through out of that group. Jackie Stewart, Jody Scheckter. This one, I think, is fairly easy, isn't it?
Yeah. Jackie has to go through for me.
Jackie has to go through. Three-time Formula One World Champion. But Jody Scheckter did win a title with Ferrari. He was the last driver to do it before Michael Schumacher. And
that
as we've said many times before, it does count for a lot in this.
Yeah, that is ridiculous that since 1979, there's been two different drivers who've won for Ferrari.
Yeah. I mean, it's just Ferrari, isn't it, really?
Yeah, yeah. But Jackie Stewart did absolute tons for the sport afterwards as well, and he's still an absolute living legend.
He is an absolute... He's God tier, isn't he? Is Jackie Stewart. Mm. As just a general person, bless you.
This will be hard. No, it won't, actually. Ayrton Senna against Jochen Rindt. Yeah, Jochen Rindt, the only posthumous champion, very sadly died, I think, one round from the end, or was it in the qualifying for the final round?
Two rounds from the end, if I'm not mistaken. It was the Italian Grand Prix. I think there were a couple of races left.
So yeah, won the championship despite that. And yeah, unfortunately, obviously never got to enjoy it. But against Ayrton Senna, one of the all-time greats. One of the greatest. Matt would probably say the greatest. But yeah, Senna has to go through.
Senna, yeah, absolutely goes through in that group. Obviously... career cut short as well, just like Jochen Rindt. But, you know, there's still, again, in my mind, I think it's fair to say Ayrton Senna could have been a six-time world champion quite easily.
Mm. Yeah, that goes a lot of the multiple champions that you've got missed opportunities, haven't you?
Yeah, yeah. Fangio Raikkonen.
I mean, Fangio is simply... the era-defining man. He has to go through for me.
Kimi was great throughout quite a few years of his Formula 1 career.
Yeah, he was extremely long-lasting.
But the idea... Let's just put it quite bluntly for one brief second. The idea of not dying in Formula 1 for 5 years, never mind winning 5 world championships, is just ridiculous.
And winning
four
whatever
teams
you drove.
As well. Yep. Four teams. He was a bit of a team hopper, wasn't he? Fangio.
No one's won back-to-back championships for different teams since Fangio.
Nope. And he did it, 3 years in a row, didn't he?
I think so.
If I'm not
certainly
mistaken.
Three and four.
Yeah.
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 So Fangio, one of the GOATs, just because he was absolutely ahead of his time, just dominated in a period where surviving a race weekend was credible enough.
And let's be fair, the idea that someone our dad's age could compete in Formula 1 is
he was, 46,
I think, when he won his last world title.
Yeah, insane.
I mean, I know everyone, obviously, back then was old, but, yeah, the idea of my dad going out now and trying to run in a Formula 1 car is just madness. This one, though, I feel is going to be quite close, Jamie.
Mm.
Emerson Fittipaldi and Mike Hawthorne.
I'll be honest, I don't know a lot about Mike Hawthorne.
Let me get up my stat sheet quickly
Emerson,
for you. As you talk about Emma, the werewolf.
Yeah, two championships, I believe.
Two world championships.
Both with McLaren?
Nope, one with McLaren, one with Lotus, if I'm not mistaken.
Interesting, fair. Yeah, kind of overshadowed by the other Brazilian world champions quite a lot, because he won in the 70s, I believe. It was certainly around
72, 74.
Just before. the likes of like Piquet and Senna came on the scene maybe 10 years later. So he's kind of forgotten when you think about Brazilian F1 champions. Mike Hawthorne, late 50s or early 60s, I believe.
Both?
Was he a two? I thought he only won one championship, Mike Hawthorne.
Oh, sorry. I thought you meant when he was driving.
Oh, yeah, yeah. 59, if I remember rightly.
Yep, I'm pretty certain you're correct on that one. I'm still trying to find my fact sheet for it.
Oh, dear. Yeah, I really...
Give me 1 second.
I would back Hawthorne just because he did it in a more difficult time. Because winning anything in the 50s, as we said, is very difficult. But Fittipaldi did win too. I don't have much to say on this match, really.
I think I'm going to say Fittipaldi for this one.
Fair.
Pretty much just because, again, he won with two different teams. Here we go, Mike Hawthorne, 1958 world champion with Ferrari. He was the other driver, British driver that won with Ferrari. And obviously, sadly, killed in 1959. Four poles, three wins. The idea that three wins could net you a world championship back then is madness. One world title for Mike Hawthorne. I'm going to say Fittipaldi for the reasons I just mentioned and the fact when I raced him on iRacing a couple of years ago, he was absolutely mad fast still. And
friend,
you know,
of the
what?
Show.
The idea that a guy competing on iRacing in his mid-70s is good enough for me.
Yeah. Send him through. You're through to the next round.
You're through to the next round, Emo. And, of course, like I said, he's a werewolf, potentially.
Yeah.
We don't know for sure. Jack Brabham, Alan Jones. You've ended up with a battle of the Aussies here, Jamie. How have you done that?
Yeah, I don't actually know. I don't know very much about either of these, but Brabham, three-time champion?
Jack Brabham, three-time world
Which
champion.
Which is probably the most
forgotten. Three-time world champion.
Yeah. And Alan Jones, just the one. The man I always forget about when doing F1 champion quizzes. 1980 for Williams, if I remember rightly.
The first ever Williams champion.
Yeah, the first of many. And, yeah, I think... simply based off success in their career, I think it has to be Brabham. But again, I hold my hands up. I know very little about either of these drivers.
Let's not forget the other big thing about Jack Brabham. Only ever Formula One world driver to win a title with a car bearing his own name.
Interesting. Very true.
So yeah. I think that for me is enough in itself to push him through. And our final round then, Jamie, of 32. Alberto Ascari and Denny Hulme. The only ever Kiwi
Hume,
world champion. Sorry, I'm still not 100%.
I would back Ascari for this. 51-52.
Yep.
No, sorry,
the first
52-53,
was two
it?
Italian champion. No, I think it was 51-52.
No, Fangio won 51.
Fangio won 51, didn't he?
Yeah.
Yeah, 52-53.
So, is he the only Italian champion still?
No. Giuseppe Farina.
Oh, of course, yeah. The last Italian champion.
Yes.
Which is amazing, yeah. Considering how big Italy are in F1. And it was 1953.
No. Ignore me. I'm getting confused for a second.
Held
you're
a lot of
right,
records
right.
for a while because of his early success. Was one time most poles, most wins, that kind of thing.
Yep.
Denny Hulme, I, again, know almost nothing about. I hate
so
to admit.
Denny Hulme, like I said, Kiwi, the only ever Kiwi world champion, like often forgotten. As well within that group, let me again just try and find my stat sheet for him. I don't think he did very well in these polls, but I think he's very, very underrated by quite a few people as well. Where is he? Come on, Denny, show your face, mate. Here we go, Denny Hulme. So the only F1 world champion from New Zealand, 1967 world title with Brabham, one pole position to his name in Formula One. 8 wins, though. Charles Leclerc would cry looking
wow.
at that ratio.
Yeah.
33 podiums. He was very, very consistent.
One pole and 33 podiums, well.
Not bad going. Fair. Not
That's
bad
like Sergio
by
Perez levels.
It is. It certainly is. But not quite on the same level as Ascari.
No.
I think Ascari has to
prevail. And we're on to our second round. There's a lot of heavy hitters in here.
There is. Oh, here we go. Straight off the bat then, Jamie. Michael Schumacher, Max Verstappen.
Yeah. Has to be Michael, annoyingly.
Oh, it has to be the Michael.
We'll revisit
Seven
in 15
against
years.
Two. What's that,
yeah.
sorry?
We'll revisit in 15 years and see what we think, but it has to be Michael for
it
now.
It has to be the Michael. Oh, this one might be a little bit closer, though. The Battle of the Three Times. Niki Lauda, Nelson Piquet.
I think Niki, as we said.
I think you're absolutely
Maybe
right.
it's a bit of bias because Nelson Piquet is very unlikable. Niki Lauda... was very likable. Sadly passed away a few years ago. But yeah, Lauda, definitely.
And we forgot to mention as well, of course, Niki Lauda, the only ever Formula One driver to win titles with both Ferrari and McLaren.
Yeah.
I feel this one is going to be quite difficult, Jamie.
Yeah. Okay,
Alan Prost, Jim Clark. This one is a really tough debate.
I naturally want to go for Jim Clark.
I also naturally want to go for Jim Clark. But I also feel that's quite unfair on Alan Prost.
It is unfair on Alan Prost. But Jim Clark was absolutely levels above anyone else at the time. He completely was nothing that anyone had ever seen before in the 1960s. And I think being ahead of your time as a driver, like redefining how the sport is looked at, means an awful lot in these kind of discussions. And that's why I think the likes of Fangio, Clark, Schumacher, they were all kind of like that next, like they were ahead of their time completely. Just pains me because I'm looking at the next one and again, I want to back the British and we're going to get accused of British bias. But
so I'm actually going to play devil's advocate here. And you said obviously how Jim Clark changed the way we view Formula One. Alan Prost did exactly the same thing.
Mm.
He was the no real Formula One driver before him. Played the numbers game as much as Alan Prost did. Known as the professor within the sport, he always made sure he did enough that he would walk away at the end of a season with the most points. He wouldn't take many risks.
And that's been a very well like copied strategy. Like the likes of Rosberg
since
did
then.
That. Since, yeah. So, this is really hard. I would feel bad whoever goes out here.
It is difficult, isn't it?
I might just give it to you.
Oh, here we go. You're going to put it on me, are you? I haven't got a coin here. I was genuinely just going to flip a coin between these two. I think just for the sake of the stats, 4-2.
Mm.
It's difficult. It's difficult. But I feel like... Oh, no, I can't go against Jim Clark. He's not even... Well, he is Great British, but he's Scottish, so we don't even want him.
We don't
him.
Like them.
Yeah. Well, yeah. But we don't like the French either, I suppose.
No, no.
Do we watch France lose again? I suppose we watch France lose again, don't we?
Yeah, send Jim Clark through. Get
we'll
a bit
send
of spice.
Jim Clark through. But that one is really,
very,
really
very tight.
Close. I think the thing is, had Jim Clark not been killed, 4 world titles was not out of the question.
No,
absolutely.
Not
Vettel or Graham Hill, Jamie? The man that won everything or the man that won everything for a few years and then didn't really win a lot after that?
Wow.
We're
going to
get hate here, aren't we?
Setting your agenda straight away.
Oh, I know. I wanted you to fight Seb's corner on this one. Win you some support back.
I think Seb in certainly 2010, 2012 absolutely was unreal. And the thing is he was doing it at such a young age.
2011, 2013 you mean?
No, because... 2011, 2013, he kind of had the car, and all he had to do was beat Webber. 2010, 2012, he was up against lots of extremely high, like Hamilton, Alonso.
2010 Red Bull should have dominated that year. I know that
he
had reliability issues,
shocking,
but it should have dominated that season more than either of those drivers got out of it. Like, if Alonso or Hamilton had been in that car, that title would have been wrapped up by about Korea.
True, but Vettel did have an awful lot of bad reliability. He made a few mistakes as well, but he was still, 22 at the time or something daft like that?
23, I think.
So, I think the thing is, Vettel, at the end of 2013, was looked at as going to be the greatest because he was still 26 and was on his way to break all the records.
He had the world in his hand, didn't he?
And then since then... Again, it's just not really gone his way at all. He had a bit of a renaissance at Ferrari when he was backed, and then they kind of found a new toy in Charles Leclerc, and it all went wrong again. I think...
I had to call the last one. You're calling this one.
I think Vettel probably just edges it.
You're saying Vettel over Mr. Monaco and the Triple Crown winner.
Yeah, well, it's F1, isn't it? F1 World Cup. It's not the Triple Crown World Cup, otherwise Graham Hill would win. And just for the stats,
he's
the numbers,
the fans.
Vettel absolutely wins.
I'll allow it. Sebastian Vettel will make it through. You just don't want people calling this bias, don't you? That you can be honest with me. Hamilton, Mika Häkkinen. Both won a title with McLaren. Häkkinen did win 2. But again, we're talking 7-2 here, aren't we?
Yeah, it's got to be Hamilton. And as you said, Häkkinen, for me, his stock does drop a bit because he did almost throw away one of his titles to Eddie Irvine.
It's weird to think, is imagine if Eddie Irvine had been Ferrari world champion before Michael Schumacher. If he'd been the one to stop the run from Scheckter.
Like, had Schumacher, obviously it's all if, buts and maybes, but Schumacher doesn't break his leg in Silverstone.
Oh yeah, it would have been done.
Easily wins the championship.
Exactly. It would have been a walkout 1999.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, here we go then. This is one I feel like we might disagree on. Jackie Stewart,
I'm not sure.
Ayrton Senna.
I would go for Senna, which I think
you'll
be pleased with.
I will absolutely agree with that.
And I think Stewart's incredibly unlucky, but Senna,
I think he is as well.
Was just like, the speed was something we hadn't seen before and probably arguably haven't seen since. It, like, when he was on his, like, his days were very regular, you know, a lot of people say on their day, like Maldonado on his day was good, but Senna on his day, which was more often than not,
it
was
pretty much every day. And yeah. I think this is the thing, isn't it, when we sort of remember, and it's always that mad thing as well, isn't it, about Ayrton Senna, where he obviously took 61 poles in Formula One, which obviously was a record for quite a few years. He only ever competed in, what, about 140, 150 Grand Prix.
And some of them were Tyrrell.
And about the first 30-odd of those, at least, and the final 15, 20, he didn't really have a car that could fight for pole position anyway. So he really took 61 poles probably in about 80 or 90 Grand Prix that he had a chance to.
Yeah.
No one was able to get everything out of a car in the way Senna would every single time.
Yeah.
And for me... like I said, we love Jackie Stewart, but when we're talking GOAT, Senna's closer to that than Jackie is, bless him.
Yeah.
Fangio Fittipaldi.
I think Fangio, straight away.
That one's a bit easier. Era-defining, quite a lot of difficult ones.
Yeah, yeah, that one's very straightforward for me.
Fittipaldi was a very, very good driver against a lot of other very good drivers. Fangio was... I mean, for a long time, people never thought we'd get 5 world championships again out of a single driver.
Yeah.
It's happened twice in this millennium, but there we are. Jack Brabham, Alberto Ascari.
Probably the weakest of these matches, I would argue.
Yeah, I would agree.
Brabham, 3-time champ. Ascari, 2-time champ. Are we going to go deeper than that? I don't know. That's very surface level, not much wheel knowledge on display, but I think I would edge Jack Brabham.
I was going to completely agree with you. I think both of them were very, very good. Both of them quite slept on.
Yeah.
But Brabham sneaks it for me. Only 8 remain, Jamie.
8 remain. These are some very tough matchups.
We're getting into some big names here. Michael Schumacher, Niki Lauda.
I think... I mean, I'm going to put it out there. For me, Schumacher is the GOAT.
He's saying it now, is he? He's saying
it now. I will struggle to be convinced otherwise by you.
Okay.
Because you've been trying for 6 years. So, yeah, I think Schumacher has to go through for me.
Yeah, I think that's fair. Lauda,
Niki Lauda, obviously,
was...
Yeah, incredible.
Lauda, definitely. He deserves to have got as far as he's got. And again, he's unlucky that he's coming up against the Michael. Because there's easily a couple of other drivers here I would argue him in favour of.
Mm.
But 2 world titles for Ferrari versus 5. The Michael... Again, he was one of very few. And I mean, Niki Lauda did change the sport as well, don't get me wrong. But you can't really go against the Michael there, can you?
No, you can't.
Jim Clark, Sebastian Vettel, and Jamie.
I think we're going to get abused, but Jim Clark, for me.
You've said it, not me. You've said it. Jamie,
I mean, we've spoken about
said...
both of them at quite a long length. But Jim Clark, for those of you who maybe are new to the sport, don't know much about the history, he was... incredible. From every eyewitness who saw him, was like, he would just like lap entire fields on quite a regular basis.
But it was the way he did it as well, because it wasn't like he absolutely dragged a car around.
He was so smooth, really one of the
first drivers to work with the car, wasn't he?
Mm. It was like he was at one with it. It was unreal. So yeah, and definitely his numbers don't tell the full story at all. He's got the record for most Grand Chelems, which is pole fastest lap, lead every lap, and a win.
Does he still have that?
I think he certainly has the best rate. I don't know if he has the most anymore.
Yeah.
But he has an incredible... He was just way ahead of his time. And sadly, lost before his time as well.
Fair enough. Fair enough.
This will be. I'll leave this one to you. Your two boys against each other.
My two favourite Formula One drivers of all time. And you know what? For me,
Hamilton going versus Senna.
Senna is going through against Lewis Hamilton. And people say that I'm like the biggest Hamilton fan going. But I know full well Hamilton would say Senna is a better driver. And like I've said before, Senna could have easily been a six-time world champion. And maybe could have got seven or eight.
Yeah, Fangio same can be said of Hamilton, but yeah.
Yeah, Hamilton could be a 10-time world champion. Had three more races in Hamilton's F1 career gone the right way.
No, it's
four more races.
It is five.
It could be 11.
Wait, it's slightly more than 5 points. Yeah.
5 points away from 10-time world champion, but people forget how close he was in 2010. Hamilton could have been an 11-time world champion. I don't know whether I need to take that back.
Yeah, the fastest car for his entire career, basically.
No, it's not. Fangio Brabham, then, Jamie.
Fangio, easily.
I think that's fair enough.
Fangio, wow, we really have got the, like, Mount Rushmore of Formula One in this Final Four.
We pretty much have, haven't we? The Michael versus Jim?
Schumacher for me. Just.
Okay.
It's close, okay. But I think Schumacher was just relentless.
Okay.
And he completely redefined the whole driver fitness thing, because when he started, drivers were just not athletes at all.
He did come into an era, yeah, where drivers weren't quite on the same level they are now. Mm-hmm. Senna, Fangio.
That's so hard. Obviously, probably both of them would, when they were alive, say the other one was better, which is probably a good thing. I would say Senna, just, which I know you're going to be a fan of.
Good. that makes me agreeing with it just that bit easier. Fangio was incredibly good, don't get me wrong. But Senna was competing against other titans and still
Fangio
walked away
is
with
shortchanged
three world
titans. A bit by lack of footage and lack of, like,
yes,
we don't know,
it doesn't help him. It doesn't help him. I will credit where it's due.
I'm glad we've come to this final.
If we
and
have
I know we,
probably
I know
come.
We're going to disagree.
We are going to disagree here, aren't we? You're going to say, yes, Michael Schumacher. I'm going to say Ayrton Senna.
Yes.
And to that, Jamie, I am going to say one simple thing.
What's that?
If Damon Hill was able to almost take the 1994 title away from Michael, Senna absolutely would have. Are you going to argue with that?
No, I'm not. But that wasn't prime Schumacher in the slightest.
No, I completely agree with you. this is just the first part. 1995, I feel like there would have been a close title fight, but I'm willing to say, for argument's sake, that Schumacher would have still walked away with that crown.
Mm-hmm.
96, good. 97, Senna would have wiped the floor. Again, that Williams was a lot quicker. I completely agree. Senna would have wiped the floor with Michael. Now,
yeah.
Senna probably then...
He
would
have been 37 at the end of 97, right?
Senna would have been 37 at the end of 97. He would have just been crowned a six-time Formula One world champion. So he would have bested Fangio's record.
Maybe would have
that,
called it
I
quits
think,
at that
is
point.
Then when he would have called it quits and been done with the sport. It would have also left Michael as only a six-time world champion come the end of his time in Formula One.
True. Yeah.
Senna also could have won, what was it, 1989, wasn't it? Or 1990?
The one he got disqualified from.
The one he got disqualified from.
Yeah, 89. That
should have been him. Seven-time world champion then.
Okay. Let me get all the hypotheticals out for Schumacher.
Okay,
yeah.
No, it's completely fair. No, genuinely, that is completely fair.
Because, well, you immediately have... 97 was his own fault. I won't, no, sorry, 99 was his own fault. I won't go into that. 97...
Was his own fault.
Wipes the floor if he doesn't break his leg.
No, you got those the wrong way around, sorry.
Oh,
you
have said, I? Yes,
yeah,
I have.
97 was his own fault. Yeah, 99 he would have wiped the floor. Yeah.
Obviously, 2000, 2004, you don't need to speak any more of.
2003, I feel, gets slept on a little bit.
Does do a slight bit because he was kind of... They changed the rules of two rounds to go to nerf Ferrari and Williams a little. But
nerf
he's
McLaren
still,
and Williams.
Sorry,
Ferrari,
McLaren and Williams, yeah. But he still delivered the championship against a lot of hotshot drivers coming for his crown. Obviously, 05 was a disaster for Ferrari, so there's no chance there. 06, he was an engine failure away from what it, like, he was going to win Japan, and that puts him ahead going to Brazil. and suddenly it's all looking rosy.
It could have been an open door, couldn't it?
Then had he not retired, 07, 08 probably go to him as well.
But you always say this, and I always remind you, Ferrari weren't going to keep him.
I think
Ferrari were
going
to bump him down
pressured.
To second driver.
Yeah, but he wouldn't have lost to Raikkonen or Massa. There's not a chance.
He could have lost... Well, the thing was, wasn't it? Ferrari had basically explained to him, Raikkonen was going to be coming in as the number one. You either let Massa have a Formula One career, or you potentially lose out to the young flying Finn, and then a lot of those titles that you've recently won when Kimi was breaking down every other weekend get called into question.
No, Kimi... 03 wasn't that bad for Kimi, was it, reliability-wise? I know 05 was shocking, but that was Alonso who won that in the end.
Yep, very true as well.
So, yeah. I mean, if you... like, I'll say 99, 06, and arguably 07, 08. But that's already 9 without those arguable ones. And he did win 7. And I think... I mean, he turned a lot of people off F1 just because of how dominant he was, which is not necessarily a good thing, but... I struggle to go against the big Michael.
I think we've just got to ask ourselves one final question, haven't we, here? You put these two at their peak on a racetrack together, who's walking away with the win?
I think if you put them off in a one-off race, probably Senna, but over a championship, probably Schumacher.
Really? At their peak?
I think...
At their peak, do you still reckon Senna was making mistakes? Because what we're basically asking each other is who ultimately... is just that bit quicker.
I mean, whatever. I know you're gonna, you're in charge of the mouse, so Senna's gonna be crowned. But I will not have my mind changed.
I think we are gonna have to agree to disagree here.
We are, and let us know in the comments, because I know, well, the whole thing has been quite like mostly we've agreed, but this one I will not agree.
we won't disagree. We won't. Back down to this one. Right, I'm going to give you one last statement then, Jamie.
Okay, closing statements.
Michael Schumacher said Senna was the greatest driver of all time.
Yeah, of course he did. They're all too humble at the top.
None of them are going to say, I am the greatest, are they?
No,
but he could have picked out any other driver. He could have picked out Alain Prost, he could have picked out Fangio, he could have picked out anyone. Schumacher said Senna was the greatest Formula One driver.
But that's just having knowledge, because everyone knows that Senna's better than Prost and Fangio.
So you're saying Michael Schumacher was clever enough to know Senna was the greatest to ever do it?
The greatest apart from himself. But he wouldn't say that. Let us know what you think in the comments.
We really are going to end up finishing this without a conclusion. Actually, you know what?
You're going to give it Senna. I'll sleep well at night, but I will disagree with you. What are you doing? I didn't actually see that. Oh, yes. What a guy.
We've done a lot of these based on raw numbers.
We have.
And as much as I love Senna, I can only talk hypotheticals.
Exactly.
It should also mean Schumacher's that Hamilton won the whole thing, but...
Schumacher's got 7 plus a load of hypotheticals.
Hamilton also, therefore, should have probably won the entire thing, but... Will you agree to concede, then, that Hamilton's better than Schumacher?
No, actually, I won't.
I'm trying to push my luck there. Fair enough.
Lost to George Russell at Equal Machinery.
Yeah. I think that went about as well as we expected it to, didn't it, Jamie?
It did.
It was good fun to see us out ready for the festive period. We will hopefully be back next week. We're going to do quite a fun... We've basically got an idea to do sort of like a quiz for the F1 2022 season. It's just going to be asking each other questions, just obviously from the 2022 campaign. But... of course, as well, I think we just both want to say, you know, a massive thank you to all of you for the insane support on the podcast this year. You know, this year we finally came up with a name for the show, which was quite good, because it ran through most of last year without a name, which was always quite funny. But, you know, we've had a lot of fun with it this year. You know, next year we've got big, big things planned as well. So we cannot thank you guys enough. You know, for those of you that are early on listeners, it is greatly, greatly appreciated. And hopefully, you know, by the end of 2023, you know, we're going to be able to have some really fun stories to look back on as well. But Jamie, as well, quickly, I just want to say to you, you know, I wish you a Merry, Merry Christmas. You know, too. Happy holidays to everyone as well that is listening. And yeah, like I said, we'll be back next week with a bit of a fun sort of 2022 quiz before. Well, I mean, really, from the first week of January, we're going to be all looking towards New Year, aren't we, Jamie?
Yeah, it's going to
be all eyes in front. So thank you all so much for listening, and we will be back very, very soon with more Knowing Wheel.